Hi, this is John. In this ittaster video, I'm going to show you how to configure group policy with Windows Server 2008 R2 and give you a few tips along the way. Group policy enables network administrators to specify a whole bunch of configuration settings from a central location and apply them to a Windows operating system on our client workstations and servers. We can control the user's desktop experience. For example, we might wish to remove access to the control panel to prevent users from making accidental changes, or we might want to configure Internet Explorer to give users the same homepage to create a more uniform environment. We can specify security settings such as the minimum length of passwords and even use it to deploy software. Let's close the Group Policy Management Editor for a second and take a look at Active Directory users and computers. Now, before we begin working with group policy, I need to make you aware that the group policies that we create will normally be applied to organizational units. Organizational units have a book icon within the yellow folder, and that's how we can tell the difference between an organizational unit, such as domain controllers, and an ordinary Active Directory container like users. I've created two organizational units, one for ittaster computers and one for ittaster users. If you want to know a little more about creating OUs, why not take a look at my video Creating and Managing Users on the ittaster channel. Now, inside the computers OU, I've placed a computer, and within the ittaster users OU, I've created a user. This is important because group policies are linked to organizational units and the configuration settings are applied to the user or computer objects that we put in the OU. To open up Group Policy Management, we need to click Start, Administrative Tools, click Group Policy Management, drill down our forest to our domain. Notice the default domain policy. Now, it's not a good idea to go messing around in there until you get really familiar with how group policy works, because it takes the highest precedent over all the other group policies. Settings in there are applied to the whole domain. That means all objects, users including the administrator, computers, servers and your domain controller, so you need to be careful. Also notice we've got a default domain controllers policy. Now again, the default domain controllers policy, you need to be a bit careful with that. It's there to ensure our domain controllers have the same security policies. Let's expand this a little bit and then we'll get on with creating a new policy. Now, to create a new group policy object and link it to an organizational unit, we need to right-click the organizational unit, choose Create a GPO in this domain and link it here. Give your new GPO a meaningful name. I'm going to call it ittaster user GPO and click OK. Now, if we expand our group policy objects container, there we can see our newly created ittaster user group policy object. If we expand the ittaster users organizational unit, we can also see that the ittaster user group policy object is linked to it. To configure our group policy object, we need to right-click it and choose Edit. Now, you'll notice the policy has two main sections and it's important to understand the difference. Computer configuration settings are applied to computers when the computer first starts up. User configuration settings are applied to the users when the user logs on. Now, we've also got policies and preferences, and the difference between these is policies are strictly enforced and the users cannot change the settings you specify. Preferences aren't strictly enforced and users can change the settings you specify. These offer more flexibility to the end user. Let's specify some user configuration policies first by expanding our policies folder under user configuration. Now, there are loads of things we can set in here. I'm just going to make a few changes so that you get the general idea and then leave you to explore things further yourself. Let's just make things a little bigger. Now, one of the things I'm going to do is restrict access to the control panel on our users' workstations to prevent them from going in there and messing around with things. So to do that, we need to click on Control Panel, and we need to go across to Prohibit Access to the Control Panel. And to open that up, you can either double click on it or right click on it and choose Edit. It's important to look at this screen carefully because it tells us the minimum operating system this setting will work with. We're fairly safe though because this goes back as far as Windows 2000. Over here we've got three settings. Not configured means exactly that. It's a neutral type setting, and I'll show you where that comes in later. Enable will set a policy, and disable will disable a policy. Read through the help section carefully because this tells us what the policy actually does. Now this one is pretty clear, but sometimes they're a bit ambiguous, so it's best to think of it this way. Enabling prohibit access to the control panel turns the policy on and prevents access to the control panel. Disabling prohibit access to the control panel turns the policy off and allows access to the control panel. Now don't think of it as enable or disabling the control panel. You are enabling or disabling what the policy says it will do. I want to prohibit access to the control panel, so I'm going to click Enabled and click OK. And we can see our policy is now enabled. Next, let's configure some proxy server settings in Internet Explorer for our users, and we'll prevent them from changing the setting. So I'm going to go across to Windows Settings, Internet Explorer Maintenance, I'm going to double click Connection and Proxy Settings. I'm going to put a tick next to Enable Proxy Settings, specify a proxy server and the port, and click OK. I want to turn off the option to automatically detect proxy settings. So we take a tick out of automatically detect configuration settings, click OK. Let's also specify the user's home page. So we click on URLs, go to important URLs, tick customize home page URL, and specify the home page URL. And click OK. And finally, we want to prevent our user from changing those proxy settings. So we need to click on Windows Components. We need to click on Internet Explorer. And we need to choose Disable Changing Proxy Settings. Read through the policy help carefully. If you enable this policy, the user will not be able to configure proxy settings. So we click Enabled and click OK. And as we can see, our policy is now enabled. So far, we've configured a Windows application, Internet Explorer. We've prevented our users from accessing the control panel and changing things in there, which should hopefully help reduce the number of support calls to the IT help desk. Let's now configure a computer group policy. Now I could configure computer settings here, but I'm going to create a new group policy to hold my computer policy settings. You don't have to do it this way. You can create everything in one policy and link the same group policy object to the OU containing all of your users and computers. But I like to keep them separate to make management much easier. Let's close Group Policy Management Editor. We need to right-click our ittaster computers OU. Click Create a GPO in this domain and link it here. Give our new GPO a meaningful name. I'm going to call it ittaster computers GPO and click OK. Our new ittaster computers GPO appears under Group Policy Objects, and if we expand our ittaster computers organizational unit, we can see that our ittaster computers GPO is linked to it. To configure the GPO, I need to right click it and choose Edit. I'm going to configure just one computer-based setting so you get the general idea. I'm going to turn off the ability to do a system restore, so I'm going to expand policies, go to administrative templates, expand system, click on system restore, right click turn off system restore and choose edit. Read through the policy description. If you enable this setting, system restore is turned off. Click enabled and click OK. Our policy is enabled. So let's log on to a client computer so we can see things from a user's perspective. We're now on our client workstation, so let's log on as Bugs Bunny. If we click start, notice we've not got a control panel. If we try and search for it and click control panel, we're prohibited from accessing the control panel. If we go to Internet Explorer, there's the default home page that we configured. If we go to Tools, Internet Options, Connections, and LAN Settings, there are the proxy server settings we specified, and as you can see, they're greyed out so that we can't change them. I'm not actually running a proxy server, in case you're wondering why my Internet Explorer isn't going anywhere. I'm now going to log on as the domain administrator. Now if we click start, you'll notice we've got our control panel back and we can access it. But if we click start and go to all programs, accessories, system tools, and click on system restore, the computer policy we set prevents us from doing a system restore. Now even though we're logged on as a domain administrator, we're still prevented from doing a system restore. And this is why you have to be careful, particularly if you're making any changes to things like the default domain policy, because you could engineer yourself out of the system. Now the reason we're able to access our control panel again is because the control panel was a user-based policy setting that we linked to the ittaster OU. The administrator account doesn't reside within the ittaster OU, so that policy simply isn't applied. Now remember, group policies are linked to OUs and the configuration settings are applied to the users and computer objects that you place within that OU. That's the end of part one. See you in part two, where we'll look at some more group policy. I hope this video has been helpful to you. Please subscribe to the ittaster channel, and thanks for watching.